heredity and evolution. So here this heredity and evolution, it is linked up with the previous lesson where we have learnt about the sexual reproduction in organisms and asexual reproduction. So in that reproduction, we learnt about the reason for evolution. So evolution is a gradual process which made the diversity possible on this planet. How many species are there? So there are thousands and thousands and thousands, millions of species are there on this planet. The scientists, they haven't yet identified the whole number of species, whole varieties of species that are present on this planet. Still they are finding some new species every day. So how this much of diversity has come onto this planet? And moreover, we learned one more thing in the reproduction. The traits or the characters are passed from generation to generation. And we learned that when there is reproduction, the young ones that are born are identical to the parent. They are similar to the parent, but they are not exactly identical. Young ones are similar to the parent, but they are not exactly identical. They have some changes. We call them as variations. So here, what is the link to these variations, to this heredity and evolution? This lesson tells us these variations, that means the changes that are happened during the copying of DNA, during the process of reproduction, these changes, they are inherited from generation to generation. This is called as heredity. So these variations and the heredity, they help in the process of evolution. This is what we are going to learn in this chapter, heredity and evolution. So variations takes place in each generation, from generation to generation. But there is some difference. If you see the asexual reproduction, asexual reproduction, the variations are less. If it is sexual reproduction, that means if the organism reproduces by sexual means, there is more chance for variation because two DNAs, mother DNA, father DNA, recombine to form a new DNA. So there are more chances, that means more variations. More variations in case of sexual reproduction, less variations in case of asexual reproduction. But whatever may be the case, asexual or sexual, variations are there in each generation, one progeny to another progeny. So now let us see how these variations lead to that concept of evolution. Let us see now. So let us see, already we discussed in the previous lesson about the variations. The variations sometimes may be advantageous. It doesn't mean that all variations are advantageous. So variations takes place, sometimes they become advantageous. Say, here we can take an example, there is a bacteria. So this bacteria, it lives at a temperature of 20 degrees, it can live, it can withstand up to 20 degrees. So some variation happened in this bacteria, in this population. So in the progenies, in the next generations, some bacteria are still able to withstand only 20, but in some bacteria, in the same species, in one of the generation, there is a variation that the bacteria can withstand 30 degrees. Or 40 degrees. So this is a variant. Both are of same species. But while copying of DNA, some errors might have occurred and which led to a variation in which this bacteria is able to withstand a temperature of 40 degrees or more. And other members, those who do not have that variations, they can withstand only up to 20 degrees Celsius. So if the environmental conditions change to high temperature, so the environment now it is having more than 30 degrees, 40 degrees Celsius. The temperature in the environment is changed. Now this variation, that is increasing the withstanding capacity of heat. So that variation, it becomes advantageous for this organism. So there may be natural changes in the environment. The organisms which have variations that help them to adapt in that particular changed environment, such cases you can say it is advantageous. Basically, this is called as natural selection. So we see every day many species are becoming extinct, but some species are surviving. It is because of the variations fetching them. So the organisms that have the variations that fetch them, that help them to live in that changing environmental conditions, so such cases the variations are advantageous. So here we are learning mechanisms by which variations are inherited. Variations are inherited. By what mechanisms the variations are inherited? To understand that, we need to know the rules of heredity. So rules of heredity, what are these rules? Who found these rules? So there was a person called Gregor John Mendel. He conducted experiments on the organisms, how these variations are inherited. So to understand or to see how the variations are inherited, you need to observe number of generations. If you take any organism as your case study example, as your specimen example, if you wanted to study how the variations are inherited in humans, for your study you need to see some 10 generations. But it is not possible in your lifetime, you cannot see 10 generations in your sample study organism. So Mendel, he wanted to study the changes that happen in generation to generation. So he selected a plant which is having a very little lifespan. So by that he can observe its progeny, number of generations, how the traits are inherited. So for that reason, he selected a pea plant which is having some contrast characters. That means the characters that can be seen to the naked eye. For that reason, he selected pea plants. He conducted experiments on pea plants. And if we study the observations of Gregor John Mendel, we can understand how the characters, how the variations are inherited from generation to generation, and how they leads to that evolution. So that part, again, the contribution of another scientist, Charles Darwin. So he made certain observations. We'll study in the second part of this lesson that will tell us about the process of evolution. Here we will understand how the traits are inherited and what are the rules of the heredity, that we can understand here. Let us see. So here, Gregor John Mendel, 1822 to 1884, he conducted experiments on pea plants. He observed a number of generations and he understood the rules, how the variations are inherited. So before we look into the work of Gregor John Mendel, first let us understand the basics of the traits, the variations or traits, the characters, how they are passed from generation to generation. See, we already discussed that every person, every organism is having two sets of chromosomes, two sets of genes that represent each character. So each trait is expressed by a gene, that is a part of a DNA. See, in man, in his cell, he is having a pair of genes responsible for one character. Say for example, length, that means height of the person. See, he is the father or the male. Height, he is having height. So he is having good height, that is some 6 feet height. I have written as a capital H, he is having good height. His height is determined by two genes, pair. The second one is, the second factor also determines the height, but it is small h, means short. But how can one how one character is expressed out? Father is tall. Father is tall. Okay, better we take capital T for tall. So the tallness is controlled by two genes. The second gene is small t means short. So a person is having two genes. One is telling you to grow tall. One is telling you to grow short. But only one is expressed out. He is tall. Means this is expressed out. This is, it is there. He is having one more gene which tells that your height should be short. But it is recessive. The other gene is dominant. So that is why it is expressed out. For every character, a pair of genes are controlling. Even here, you see the mother, she is short. The height determining genes in her body, both are small t. Both genes are telling that short. So she is short here. So here, now there is reproduction by these two parents. So, in sexual reproduction, they contribute their genes. Here, the male contribute one set of genes in the germ cells, reproductive cells, not two sets of genes. So, he has given this set of gene here. This set of genes. Father contributed this set of genes. It is small t. Okay, better we take this. Here the father contributed this set of genes, which is big T. And mother contributed this set of genes. Anyway, in both the cases, she is having small t. So, here the boy, how he will be? Tall or short? Here, he has got a set of genes. In that set, one gene is determining the height. Here, what he acquired from the mother, in that set, the gene that determining the height is short. From the father, the set of genes that he acquired, the set of genes, in that the gene determining the height is tall. So, in this case, the boy is tall. Because this tall is a dominant character. Of course, the boy is having the gene which can make short also. But that gene is suppressed. That trait is suppressed by the tall because tall is a dominant trait. So here we can understand one concept that every character, every trait is controlled by two genes in every organism. So if you understand this, we can understand the experiments conducted by Gregor Zorn Mendel. That is the reason you might be wondered. So your father may be in fair complexion or dark complexion. Your mother may be fair complexion. So you will get one. You may be very dark complexion you may get. That means you may acquire the character trait from your father. You may be very fair as like your mother. So you may acquire that fairness character trait from your mother. So the traits, they are expressed by a set of genes. So now let us see the experiments conducted by Gregor John Mendel. So now let us see the experiment that was conducted by Gregor John Mendel. Here we can see two generations. Progeny 1, progeny 2, F1, F2 we can see here. So already I told you that why he has selected pea plants. Because there are some characters which are visible to outside, which we can observe generation to generation, what changes happened, how the characters are inherited, we can observe it. So such characters are contrasting characters. What are those? Tallness and shortness. Pea plants, they have contrast characters. Some pea plants are tall, some are short. Some pea plants have round seeds, some have wrinkled seeds. Some pea plants have green seeds, some have yellow seeds. Some have white flowers, some have violet flowers. So these many variations are there in pea plants. That is the reason why he has selected the pea plants for his experiment. So here, this experiment is based on the height of the pea plant, tall. So he selected a pea plant with tall and short, two pea plants. So these two pea plants are cross-pollinated. The tall pea plant, it is having capital T means, I told you before this, I told you that every character, every trait is expressed by two genes. One is dominant, one is recessive. So in this case, in the tall plant, both the genes are expressing tallness, TT. Both the genes are expressing the same character, tall, tallness. Whereas the other plant, it has got two genes, pair of genes for the character, small t. So that is why it is short. So if cross-pollination takes place between this and this, the seeds that are obtained from these plants are planted. So in the first progeny, what is observed here? All the plants are tall, but for outside, just to look outside, all are tall. But let us see the ratio. Let us see their genes, whether both the genes are expressing tallness or not. No. One gene is expressing the tall trait, the other one is expressing the short. But the plant looks tall because the tall is the dominant character. The second case also capital T, small t. Third case also capital T, small t. Fourth case also capital T, small t. All the four plants, they have both the genes. The gene which is expressing tallness, which is expressing shortness. But outside only one thing is seen. A plant can never be short and tall at a time. It can either be short or tall. Here it is only tall because it is the dominant character. So now, here, again, F1 plant and F1 plant are crossbred for the second progeny. F1 into F1. How is that F1? Here this is the F1. In F1, two genes, one is capital T, the other one is small t. One is expressing tallness, the other one is expressing shortness. Here tallness and shortness. So now these are crossbred. So what is the result here? Out of this, we got 1/4 short and 3/4 tall. 3/4 plants are tall. 1/4 is short. Out of 4, 1 is short. So the short plant has got small t. Both the characters are short. That is why it is short. In the other case, 50% out of 4, 2 are one capital T, one small t. Means one dominant character as well as it is carrying the recessive character also. Shortness expression gene is also there. Only one, it is having both the dominant characters, TT. So in the second generation, 25% is having completely dominant, 25% is having completely recessive traits, and the 50% is having mixed, one dominant and one recessive gene. But to look outside, all the three are tall, one is short. So this is how the inheritance of variations takes place. So Mendel conducted some more experiments. In this case, he considered only one contrasting character, tall or short. In the next experiment, he has taken two different contrast characters. He considered tallness, shortness, at the same time, their seeds. One plant with round seeds, one plant with wrinkled seeds. Likewise, in a combination of different contrast characters he has taken for the further experiment to understand better how these traits are inherited. Let us see. Now, let us see the rules of inheritance by taking two contrast characters. Earlier, we have seen that only one contrast character, that is either short or tall. Tall plant, short plant. Here too. What is that? Here we are considering the color and shape of seeds of pea plant. So here in the initially, the seeds are taken like the seeds which are round. The roundness is determined by both the genes capital R and green. It is determined by small y. On the other side, we have taken a seed which is wrinkled and yellow. Wrinkled yellow. The wrinkliness is shown by small r, small r. Yellow is shown by capital Y, capital Y. The first one is round green. Both are crossbred. Here in the first generation F1 progeny, you got capital R, small r, means this is the dominant character. So you got it as round capital Y, small y. The capital Y, it denotes that yellow. So round and yellow. Round and yellow seed you got in the F1 progeny, first generation. Now you have taken two same kind of first generation seeds and cross-pollinated, cross-fertilized, cross-bred. Cross-breeding has taken place between the F1 and F1. So in this case, the result is we get 315 round yellow seeds, 108 round green seeds, 101 wrinkle yellow seeds, 32 wrinkle green seeds. The ratio is 9:3:3:1. What does it shows? So the characters are independently inherited. It doesn't mean that the round and green, roundness and greenness, both are not linked. So the characters, the traits are independently inherited. See here, the different combinations he got. Actually, he has taken round green, wrinkle yellow. But he got round yellow, round green, wrinkle yellow, wrinkle green. So, this is the different combinations takes place because the traits are inherited individually. And the one more important thing is that each and every trait is represented by two genes. Now, let us see how the traits get expressed. So each trait is controlled by two genes. So what is a gene? Gene is a part of DNA. DNA is the genetic material. So where is this DNA present? It is present in the nucleus. So the DNA, it consists of two genes for each character. See, we already know that we share the DNA from two different organisms, father and mother. So when you are sharing, you see that if the two genes that are controlling a single character are on the same DNA strand, say for example, these are the two genes which are controlling the height. So here the parent is having two sets of chromosomes. Two sets. One set is passed in the sexual reproduction. If the genes that controlling a character, if both the genes are on the same strand, if this strand is not passed, this strand is passed, then what happens? There are no genes which can control the, which can decide the height. Will it happen? No. See, the DNA will have two strands. But when the cell is about to divide, the DNA changes into chromosomes. So the genes, they become into two sets separate. Chromosomes become into two separate sets. So, a character is expressed by two genes, but both the genes will not stay on the same strand. Even though a character is expressed by two genes, both the genes are not on the same strand of the DNA, or both the genes are not found in the same chromosome. So one in one chromosome, one in one chromosome. Then only it is possible for the individual inheritance of the characters, otherwise it is not possible. Okay, now let us see how it is executed. The changes are executed. Say for example, here a character is inherited. What is that character? Tall. The boy should grow tall. So genes, they have carried the variation, carried the trait to the boy. Now the boy has to grow. How this is executed? The tallness is there in his genes. The instruction is there in his genes, he should grow tall. How it is executed? Let us see. The instruction is there in the gene of the boy that he should grow tall. Now this tallness, whatever the gene is there, that gene, by using the cell apparatus, by using the cellular apparatus, mitochondria, cytoplasm, Golgi complex, especially the Golgi complex and all, it prepares a protein. That is nothing but enzyme. So what enzyme it prepares? When it prepares? When the gene is having tall, it prepares more enzyme. So the DNA contains a gene which is responsible for the tallness of the boy. That gene, it produces more enzyme. What does this more enzyme does? It produces more hormone. It is responsible for the production of more hormone. The more hormone is responsible for more growth. The boy grows tall, 6 feet, 6.2, 6.4 tall. Why some boys are growing tall? Because their gene is producing more protein, which turns into more enzyme, which converts more hormone, which prepares more hormone in the body, growth hormone. More growth hormone results in more growth. Say for example, the boy is having a gene which determines the height as short. So that gene, it will make less protein, less enzyme. So less hormone, so less growth. This is how the genes are linked to the final execution. So the genes will get the program. The DNA will have that complete program. DNA is nothing but the set of genes. So many traits are there, so many characters are there. So we have so many characters. Of course, all the characters are not seen externally. See here, we find some kind of differences and similarities between your friends. You might be observing in your classroom. If you compare with your friends, there you will find some differences in the skin complexion, in the hair color, in the pupil color, in the nose pattern, and in your ears, ear endings, ear lobes. Some are attached, some are free. So that height differences, even though they are of same age, your age is 15, their age is 15, even though they are taller than you, they may be shorter than you. So likewise, you find so many differences. At the same time, you find some similarities. They will be having two eyes, you have two eyes. They have 10 fingers, you have 10 fingers. They have 10 toes, you have 10 toes. Two legs, likewise, similarities, differences. All this happens because of the genes they acquire from their parents. But every character, every trait is expressed by two genes. That is what we have to learn here. And here, how it is expressed there? So why some people are dark? So again, the gene. The gene, it prepares a substance called melanin. If the gene is preparing more melanin leads to darkness of the skin. If the gene is preparing the proteins which will produce less melanin. So less protein is prepared by the gene, less melanin. Less melanin means fair skin. So people, if they have less melanin or no melanin, they have very fair skin. Melanin content is less. If melanin content is more, they have darker complexion. So the darkness or fairness is decided by what? By the amount of substance, melanin. Who decides the substance of melanin? It should be high or low. It is decided by some enzyme. Who will decide that the enzyme should be produced more or less? It is decided by your genes. So gene is the final one who decide how much amount of substances and hormones are to be produced. Depending upon the amount of hormones produced, the changes takes place in our body. So the characters are expressed. The traits are expressed out because of this connection between gene to enzyme to hormone to final execution or expression. So this is the connection. So now let us see the another concept, sex determination. So here we are discussing that each and every trait is expressed by two genes. So there is a trait, the newborn young one, whether it will be a male or female, what decides it? How it is determined, how it is decided whether the born baby is male, is going to be a male or a female. So that is called a sex determination. In animals, in lower forms, in some of the organisms, the sex determination is based on environmental factors. Various environmental conditions decide whether the newborn baby will be a male or a female. In some cases, the temperature decides. Many animals, they lay the eggs. The temperature at which the eggs are hatched decides whether the born baby will be a male or female. So here temperature is also, we can consider it as an environmental factor. So in case of these eggs hatching, the variations in temperature can bring about change in the sex of the organism. So here it is temperature linked. And in some organisms, you see like snails, they can change the sex, male to female. So these are all in the lower forms. Let us talk about the humans, how the sex is determined in humans. In humans, the sex determination takes place purely by genes. Depending upon the genes acquired by both mother and father. As we have discussed earlier, father, mother, they have two sets of genes, two sets of chromosomes, and during sexual reproduction they share one set. Here two sets are there, 2N, 2N, 1N is given here, 1N is given here, 1N plus 1N, 2N. The young one will have two sets again. Here, in case of father's body, the reproductive cell of male, it will have two genes that determine the sex, X and Y. In mother, both are X. So the character of female is represented by both X in mother. In father, X, Y. This is one set, this is one set, this is one set, this is one set. But we know that they cannot contribute two sets, only one set they have to contribute. So in this one set, if mother contributes X, father contributes Y, it will be a boy. YX combination or XY combination, right? So that means YX. If father contributes X, mother contributes X, it is XX girl. So it is in the hand of the father whether the born baby will be a boy or a girl, determined only by the father here. So from the father genes, if X gene is given to combine with the other gene from the mother, it will be a girl. If Y gene is given, so here the X gene, always X here, because both the things are X. So mother always contributes X. Mother always contributes X because she has only X which determine the sex. But father has two, X and Y. He can either give X or Y. So the sperm cell which fertilizes the egg, if it is having Y, then it will be a boy. The sperm cell if it is having X, the egg also X, XX girl. The sperm is having Y, egg is X always. So YX boy. In this way, the sex determination takes place in human beings. So here we have seen the variations, how the variations they inherit from one generation to another generation. The second part is that evolution. So we learned about heredity. Now let us see the evolution. Both are linked together. So evolution means formation of a new species, which is a very gradual process. But how the new species is evolved from the pre-existing species? A new species comes from the pre-existing one by accumulation of so many variations. And not only that, there are some other factors which also leads to the formation of new species. So let us see what are those factors. Basically, the basic idea of evolution is explained with an illustration here, that is taking an example of some beetles and their colors. Let us see that what is that illustration. Here there are some set of beetles. In a jungle, in a forest, there are some red color beetles. So these are all red color beetles. They are in the forest, that is, they are in the leaves, they are feeding on the leaves of the bushes. So as they are red in color, the bushes are green in color, which are quite contrast. They are easily identified by the crow which eat the beetles. Crows can easily identify the red color beetles because they are contrast and opposite color to the leaves. So by that, the crows, they pick and eat the red color beetles. Suddenly, what happened is that in the red color beetle population, one variation has occurred. One of the beetle, it has got green color. That is a variation. And this variation, this change, it has happened through the genes. So by that, it can pass this variation to its progeny. The green color can be passed to the next generations. So this is a variation. Now what happened? Because of this green color, as the green color blends with the leaves of which are in green color, so the green beetle is not being eaten by the crows. Crow cannot identify the green beetle because the leaves are green. Camouflage takes place. That means blending of its color with its surroundings. So only the red beetles are identified. Green beetles are not identified by the crows. So the green beetle population is increasing because crows are not being eaten. Crows are not eating the beetles. So beetles are not being eaten by the crows. Why the green beetles are not being eaten by the crows? Because the green beetles are not identified as they are in green in color. So crows are identifying red. So gradually the population of red beetles is decreased and green beetles increased. You can see that here the green color is an advantageous variation for the beetle population. So by the generations and generations on, you can see the green beetle population is more, red beetle population is less. So the variation, the green color, it fetched the organism. So this is the situation one. Now let us see the another situation. Now let us see the second situation. Here again the same background, that is the forest. There are a group of beetles which are red in color. They are being eaten by the crows. Red is a contrast color, so by that the crows can easily pick up the beetles. So suddenly there is a variation. There a beetle developed a blue color. In the first situation we have seen a green color. Here the variation is blue color. So the blue color beetles, that is a variation which it can pass to the progeny. The blue color beetle is also producing blue color beetles. But the crows, they can identify the blue color better than the red color. So the red beetle population is more, the crows are identifying blue color, so the blue population is less. So here the variation is not advantageous in this case, in the second situation. Now suddenly what happened? An elephant stepped on these beetles. This is the elephant foot. So the elephant stepped and all the beetles died except a few, which are only blue. Only a few blue beetles, they survived. Rest of the beetles died. So only these four blue beetles. So what happens? The blue beetles, they continue their progeny. After generations and generations, only the mostly the new generations will be blue. So it became a very important character of the beetle, that is blue color. Actually, it started as a very rare variation. Here rare, all are red, only one is blue, rare variation. But here the total group is blue, the whole generations are blue. Means a single rare variation can become a common characteristic of an organism. That we can understand from this situation. Now let us see the differences between the two situations. In the first situation, whatever the variation is has occurred in this beetle population, that variation, it is an advantageous variation. Advantage for the green beetle population to grow. You can say it is an adaptation. Blending with surroundings to survive is an adaptation. It led to the survival of the green beetle population. You call it as natural selection. Natural selection. So the variations that help, that are helpful for the survival of the organism, that is called as natural selection. So this is one way how the evolution takes place. That means how the variations that bring out differences here in the populations. In the second situation, here the variation is not advantageous. It is not helpful for the survival of the beetle. The blue color is not at all helpful for the survival of the beetle. But even then, the blue color beetles are evolved. That means, even though the variations are not helpful, even though the variations are not adaptations, not helpful for adaptation, even then in some cases, the variations are passed. That means, even though they are not helpful, it doesn't mean that only the helpful variations they pass. So evolution takes place with adaptation, without adaptation also, that we can observe it here. So this is the basic idea of genetic drift. In this case, it is accidental. Here the elephant, it stamped on the beetles. That's why the blue beetle survived. The population of the beetle is very small. That's why when the elephant stamps it, all the other color beetles died and blue beetles existed. Accidental. So such kind of accidents, when the populations are small, it may bring the evolution with the variations which are not helpful also. So here the variation is useful variation, here the evolution process goes on. Here without any useful variation, without any adaptations also, we can observe that evolution. So we see from these examples, we take one more situation. So whatever the red color beetles are there, these beetles are growing on the bushes. Suddenly the bush has got some disease. So because of the disease, the leaves are becoming very small. The leaves are eaten by some other insect. Or the bush has got some infection, so whether there is no food in the leaves. So beetles, they grow in their size, number of beetles are more, bushes are less, food is less. So the beetles, they reduce in their size. The beetle size is reduced. Small. Can you consider this as a variation? Due to the insufficiency of the food, the organism reduces in its size. Do you think it is a variation? So can this variation, we cannot say it is a variation because it is not variation, but do this, will this change reflect in the next generations? No. So it will not happen, because if the leaves grow properly after the certain time, after the disease period of the plant is completed, again the leaves are growing well, then the beetles eat on that and they grow in size. So the change, the variation must, means the variation means it should be, the change should happen in the genetic material of the organism, in the germ cells of the organism. Unless until the DNA is not changed, the genes are not changed, the change is not reflected in the next generations. This was tested. So inheritance means there must be change in the genetic material. The genes must be changed regarding that character, then only it is possible. Otherwise it is not possible. So to test that, several scientists conducted experiments. See, they have taken a mice. They cut the tail of the mice. So the next generation mice, it is born with tail, even though the tail is cut. So likewise, so many generations, they cut the tail of the mice. But even then, generation after generation, the new generations, they are born with tails. Why? Why it is like that? Because cutting of tail is a physical one. It does not make any change in the genes of the rat. It is not a variation. Even though 100 times, in 100 generations, you get the tail of the mother, or you will not get the tailless mice. All the mice are born with tail. Means, physically, if a person accidentally loses a hand or leg in an accident, it doesn't mean that his children will be born without hand or leg. It is not inherited. The inheritance happens only if there is any change in the genetic material, only if the changes are variations, that means changes in the genes, that is only reflected in the progenies, coming up generations. If you like this video, please give a thumbs up. Please subscribe to our channel to get more videos on CBSE syllabus.